You're listening to the B&H Photography Podcast. For over 40 years, B&H has been the professional source for photography, video, audio, and more. For your favorite gear, news, and reviews, visit us at bnh.com or download the B&H app to your iPhone or Android device. Now here's your host, Allan Weitz.
Greetings and welcome to the B&H Photography Podcast. If you've ever looked down from a perch on a mountaintop or had a window seat on a plane, you know how magical it can be to stare down at the world from high above. Our guest today is documentary and fine art photographer Jeffrey Milstein, who's one of the few aerial photographers with a recognizable signature style. When I see a Jeff Milstein photograph, I can usually nail it. Jeff's work is infused with the complexity of observation, with the fascination of how similar forms repeat themselves in distinctive ways. And these themes are reflected in his four books: Cuba, Aircraft, The Jet is Art, Small Dreams, about trailer homes in Palm Springs, and his most recent book, LANY, described as a unique dual aerial portrait of Los Angeles and New York, a stunning case of compare and contrast from a bird's eye point of view. A California native with an architecture degree from Berkeley, Milstein has since migrated to upstate New York, where he's established his distinctive voice. Jeff's work has been exhibited throughout the world, including at the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum, the Morgan Lehman Gallery, and the Portland Art Museum. His work is in the George Eastman Collection in Rochester, and he currently has an exhibition of aerial photos on display at the Ben Ruby Gallery in New York that's running until March 17th, 2018. Welcome, Jeff.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Pleasure to have you here. Before we start the show, it's time for Al's Gearhead Pick of the Week. A few months ago, we had Bellamy Hunt of Japan Camera Hunter fame on our podcast. We had a blast recording that show, and before he left, he tossed us a few rolls of Street Pan 400, a new ISO 400 speed black and white film he was about to bring to market. It's really a nice film, and now it's available in 35mm 36 exposure rolls, as well as 120 rolls of film on the B&H website. Street Pan 400 features a fine-grained two-layer emulsion on a transparent polyester base with anti-scratch and anti-static coatings. We're heading into spring, so pop a fresh battery into your favorite film camera, load up a roll of Street Pan 400, and go make art. Okay, let's do the show. Jeff, welcome again. Your work seems to have a lot going on in terms of form and pattern, and quite frequently of industrial and human-made environments. How has your interest and background in architecture influenced your approach to photography? Let's preface that. You were an architecture major before you became a photographer. Is that correct?
An architect, practicing architect.
Okay. Residential or commercial?
I did some of each.
Okay. And what about photography? How did photography find its way into this?
Well, I came into architecture from an art background. So I was always in the arts. I painted, I drew. And I got a camera. Actually, when I graduated junior high school, I got an 8mm movie camera. And the first thing I did was go out to the airport and start filming airplanes.
So this aircraft goes back a ways.
It goes back a ways.
Okay.
I was an airplane nut as a kid. I built all the models. I read everything I could. My favorite Sunday morning thing was to go out to the airport, LAX, and get as close to the end of the runway as you could and have the planes come flying right over my head as they were landing. I just loved that. It goes back a long way.
How satisfying is it then to, all these years later, you know, the work that you're being most recognized for, to some degree anyway, are these images of airplanes.
Airplanes, and also what I was going to say is I started taking flying lessons when I was 15 in Santa Monica at the airport there. I used to go out to the airport in the morning, and they would let me sweep out a hangar. It took about 3 hours, and they would give me an hour flight time in a Cessna 150.
That's how I got this podcast gig, you know.
Sweep it up.
I was just sweeping the lobby a few years ago, and slowly but surely I got up to the fourth floor.
There you go.
So anyway, so go ahead.
So one of the things I liked to do early on was I took that 8mm camera and I started filming from the air. And I actually still have some of the 8mm film, and I looked at it not too long ago, and I actually am consistent because I photographed some of the same places back then that I did, you know, 50-something years later.
Is it safe to assume that it's not as easy to stay at the end of a runway and hang out right now than it was 50 years ago?
You know, you're outside the airport. You're not inside. And I have certain spots that I've found. But I'll tell you, I started shooting a little before 9/11, and I didn't shoot for a year after 9/11. I just thought no one's going to want to really look at an airliner flying overhead. And then I slowly started doing it again, and the cops would converge on me out at the airport. And then after a while, I think they just figured out who I was, and I would tell them and show them pictures of what I was doing. But I know there's a helicopter that always is flying around LAX, and I know they're looking down saying, oh, there's Jeff again.
So the photos of airplanes then are mostly from
LAX. Okay. Some I've done at air shows, some of the military. Right. Oshkosh has this incredible air show they put on every year, and I've gone there 3 times.
And did it take you a while to get to that spot? And I don't mean the physical spot, but the spot where you realized this direct shot underneath was the one you liked?
Yes, it did, because I didn't come to that right away. In fact, I started trying, you know, photographing the planes coming across the street and over the industrial areas. And then as they were coming in, but not directly under. And then slowly it morphed into directly under. And directly under on a day which was lightly overcast became the form of the typology, which they all ended up being that kind of
look. I was going to ask you about, we were talking about that because all of the, if you haven't seen the pictures, the ones we're discussing right now, Jeff takes pictures looking straight up as of aircraft going directly over his head. And it takes on a wallpaper pattern if you look like 20 of them side by side. They're interesting individually and as a group. But all the skies are kind of whitish, and I was kind of saying to myself, do you just take pictures at noon in July? Because they're very specific. Or do you fake this post?
No. I mask it, and I eliminate the sky. So I'm creating a portrait of the plane. You know, it becomes reductive and a little bit like a work of art in a sense that it's not a pure photograph. The plane is, but you know, the background is dropped away. Mm-hmm.
What's interesting about, especially when you see these printed large, the aircraft themselves are pretty imposing. And the different manufacturers and the different airlines, they have different markings and stuff like that. What I find interesting is the dirt patterns under the wings and the lubricants and all the stuff, the staining.
Interesting story. There was a recession in, was it around 2008?
Yeah.
And the airplanes got dirtier. They were not cleaning them as much during that time because I think everybody was having trouble maintaining
fuel
the
prices
balance
were
sheets.
Going up and everything. And interesting.
Yeah, I definitely noticed that. And then I won't say which airlines, but there were some planes I could not get a direct shot underneath. They just never lined up with the runway.
That's funny. And another question I have regarding, and you maybe answered it to some degree, the post-processing that you're doing on these, are they all taken in that exact same spot, or do you then adjust the way they are within the frame?
I'm actually shooting them on the diagonal of the frame to get the biggest picture I can get. And then so later on, I'll, of course, straighten it out. You can't fix it if you're not directly under the shot. And sometimes, even if you're directly under the plane, they're constantly dropping a wing and raising a wing to maintain their position. So sometimes I think, oh, man, I got this great shot, and right over me drops a wing, and I throw it away. Now, there are people who've sort of come in and done things similar to what I've done later, but they never get them perfect. I've noticed that. Like, I walk away at the end of the day with a couple of good shots that I'm going to use, and I throw away the rest because I don't use them if they're not perfect. And I shouldn't say this because now other people figure out what I'm doing.
And after you've done so many, what other than the alignment, what is it you're looking for? I mean, there's colors, of course, and the different patterns that they have.
But yeah, I mean, some of the nicest ones were the American Airlines ones when they had them all silver. United has gone to a completely different paint job. I mean, I've got ones that you'll never see again. That they, you know, they're the airlines have all merged. It used to be a number of airlines, and now it's three, and the paint jobs have gotten pretty bland and similar. Yeah, but
I was looking at a few weeks ago, I was in Los Angeles, looking at all the paint jobs, and they really have gotten awful.
Yeah. Now, I should say Southwest still has a series. They have one for each state, or at least a lot of the states. And what they do is they paint it up somehow, like the one for Maryland is based on the Maryland flag. It's very colorful. And they have the one for Nevada has pictures of their state flower on it. And then Alaska has some very cool ones.
They have, yeah, bold, very bold graphics.
They have, yes. Well, they've got a Disney one, which is very cool. It's in the book. And they've got, Southwest has an orca. They painted it like an orca. That one's in the book also.
Yeah, yeah.
So I've caught a lot of them, which I've put in the book. I don't have every one, and they change them from time to time.
What's the, for you anyway, other than the, you know, your love of aircraft, it seems like a lifelong love. What is the artistic thrill? Is it the repetition of the pattern, or is it about the accumulation and inventorying, or what do you, what's the thrill?
When they're flying over you and they're very close, then, you know, they're big and they thunder over you, you get about a second of them overhead and they're gone. And I like capturing that moment. And so you could stand there and look at a 50-inch or 60-inch print, you know, and just marvel about, you know, all the detail, the rivets and everything. And, I mean, people will come in. Sometimes I hang some in my studio and people come in, they say, you know, what did you do? Is this a model or, you know, I have an engineer friend, and he looked at him when he first saw them and he starts calculating. He says, I don't see how you do this without blurring, you know.
Yeah, right. Can you mention that a little bit about the settings you use?
Well, I shoot as fast as I can for the light, obviously. Mm-hmm. You know, I try to shoot around 2/1000ths of a second. When the light starts going down, then, you know, you have to adjust and hope for some that aren't blurry. Mm-hmm. I don't use a tripod. I hand hold.
I was going to ask you about
that.
Yeah. Are you on continuous high speed, or are you just trying to get that one image?
Oh, you could only get one. The fastest camera made, you're only going to still get one. It's moving so fast. And
But you're shooting in continuous. You're not you're not depending
on
your one.
You get a fraction of a second when it's overhead directly. So that's another thing is like I have some and they're slightly forward or slightly back, you know, because I didn't hit you have to time it because the shutter has a fraction of a lag.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And the plane is moving fast. So you have to judge the time to hit the shutter slightly before it's going to be where it is. And sometimes you nail it and sometimes you don't. But that, for me, is part of the whole process. It has to be in a perfect position.
Are you laying on your back or standing up?
I'm standing up.
Okay.
And I go back as far as my neck will go.
So what camera are you using?
Well, let me tell you what I started with, because my favorite camera was the Contax, and Allan remembers
this. Oh, yeah, the
645 Contax. And then the first digital back for it was the Kodak back, 16 megapixels, a square picture.
It was the Pro back, right?
Yeah, and that was the first one, and I dived in with that and started shooting with that back. And then Phase came out with a 22 megapixel. So I traded. They took it as a trade, and I went to the 22. And the airplane series started really with the 22 megapixel. I still have a number in the portfolio that were from that 22. It was the Contax and the Zeiss 45-90, which is arguably one of the best zoom lens ever made. And so then I kept trading up. I went to the 40 megapixel, the 60 megapixel, the 80 megapixel, and now I have the 100 megapixel.
Okay. Wow. And what is the lens? I know you mentioned the zoom, but what do you use normally?
Now I'm using that for aerials now. Mm-hmm. I'm not really I haven't been shooting underneath for a while so much. So if I did, I would have to switch lenses. I don't have the zoom lens for it. And to be honest, I don't like it. The corners I didn't think were as sharp as the prime lenses. So I did also use the Alpha for a while with the phase. And those lenses are superb, but they're not good for shooting airplanes. They're fine for shooting out of the helicopters.
What is the difference between shooting down from an aircraft and shooting up at aircraft? What makes it better or worse?
You need first of all, you need a fast lens, and you need a shutter that's quick.
Okay.
The Phase 1 IQ, the Phase 1 FX, is it XF camera? Now, that has a good shutter. It's fast enough. But I haven't really done it. I haven't gone out to the airport. And the thing is, having a zoom lens is the best if you're in an airport, because the planes are all different sizes. And so otherwise you're going to constantly be changing your lens. And then you have to figure out how big is that plane, you know, a ways out. Now, I can tell what the makes and models are pretty far out, but you've got to have time to get your lens on, you know, before it's right over you. And they move so fast when they're...
And I guess I kind of asked this question prior, but of the series where you're looking up at the jets, is there one favorite spot that you have, physical spot?
Yes, there's a spot in L.A.
And you return to that same spot?
Yeah.
All the time. Okay. And
actually, there's more than one. They have a south runway and a north runway, and I sometimes do the south and sometimes the north.
Yeah. And you're also shooting mostly midday because the light is very uniform.
Yeah, but you can't shoot right in the middle of the day because the sun is going to get in your picture.
Yeah.
So you have to go a little before, a little after, or the winter is fine because the sun's not so high.
Right.
And in terms of the post-production, how much time would you say you spend on an image with the masking and correction?
Hours. Yeah. I could spend quite a bit of time on post-production, and both for the aerials and the airplanes.
When did you flip? Because I love the aircraft.
Yeah.
But the pictures that blow me away the most are the cruise ships.
Oh yeah. So after I had done, I love them too. They're amazing. I mean, I'd gotten a nice portfolio of the aircraft together and everything was humming along. And then, like in any world of production or art, you have to have something next, something to follow. Yeah. And so I started thinking, you know, what would fit in that category? And, you know, the aircraft is an amazing piece of machinery. Well, these cruise ships are these amazing. I think I read an article in the paper about new cruise ships being built and how incredible they were. And I scratched my head and said, I'm going to get a helicopter. I'm going down to Florida and I'm going to start photographing these. So I did that. And that worked out really well. I was able to get the shot I wanted that I envisioned. I was shooting the 80 megapixel at that time, and I was using the incredibly sharp 4x5 lenses on an Alpha. And so that started that. And it fit right in because, you know, it was, again, a portrait of
something of
amazing
immense scale, but
machine.
It's the complete opposite of the aircraft. The aircraft, you're looking up midday.
Right.
And here you're at midnight looking down over cruise ships in the ocean.
Well, not all of them are at night. A lot of them are the last bit of sun. I want that beautiful Vermeer light, you know.
But it's the lighting, the artificial lighting on the boats. When they look like elongated jukeboxes from the 50s.
Yeah.
They have an incredible look at about them. And it takes a few moments to register what it is, because the scale is totally wrong and everything. Mm-hmm. And you say, oh my God, that's a ship I'm looking at.
Right.
And just a little bit of the wake coming off, and then it goes off into just a black inkiness.
Yeah.
It's stunning.
Yeah. Phase one, just I gave them permission to print 470-inch ships on metal, and they put them in their corporate offices.
Wow. Ooh, nice.
Wow. That's beautiful.
Oh, Yeah. If they have any outtakes, I'll take one of them. You know, fingerprints on the edges and stuff. I'm okay about that.
Not picky, right?
Not picky at all.
And the post-processing on them, is it a similar, work?
Obviously turning to vertical, cropping, mm-hmm. you know, sometimes filling in a little ocean in the corners or mm-hmm. something, you know.
Yeah. Are you taking commercial assignments at all, or is this all your own work?
I have had a few commercial assignments. Bloomberg flew me out to Gatwick Airport 2 years ago, and I shot that for them. And then the airport saw the pictures, and they wanted to get some of them, and Bloomberg wouldn't release them because the article got pushed up. And so they flew me out again to take them for them. I did a shoot for Esquire some years ago, which started the Black Box series. I went up to shoot a black box from a helicopter crash, terrible crash off of Newfoundland. And they wanted me to photograph the helicopter, but Sikorsky would not fly one for us because the article was a little bit critical of Sikorsky. Mm. So I did photograph the black box in which came out. The article was called The End of Mystery. You can still find it online. It's a very interesting story of what happened.
And that's a very interesting series, which is on your website, and we encourage people to take a look at it.
Yeah.
But compared to the other stuff and these kind of grand scaled, whether they're aircraft, cityscapes, or cruise ships, these are a series of straightforward shots of mangled voice recording boxes from crashes.
Right.
And they, you know, when you see them together, the stories just kind of come pouring out of them, even though you don't know the obvious stories. You can just kind of imagine, and they're pretty powerful.
Yeah.
Especially as a group.
Yeah. You know? They're very charged with the history.
Yeah, that's interesting. And when was that series done?
Oh, that was a while ago. It was probably, I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago, I would think, that I went up there. And then what happened, I wanted to do more of them, because what happened was I was in Ottawa and at the NTSB, and I photographed the one they sent me to photograph, and I photographed the inspectors and all this stuff. And then I saw a shelf with a bunch of other ones, and I said, can I photograph the other ones also? And so they let me do that. And I came back to the U.S. and I'm thinking, this is a very interesting portfolio. Let me contact the U.S. NTSB. And they said, you can't photograph here.
I was going to ask you that.
Yeah. So I kind of given up on getting more of them. And I'm reading the New York Times one day. Then there's an article about the inventor of the black box, which is actually an orange box.
Yeah, it's true.
And turns out it was invented in Australia. So I contacted the Australian Transportation Safety Board, and they said, come on over, Mighty. And my daughter had been asking me, can we visit Australia for some time? I don't know why.
And you kept saying, not until I can deduct it on my taxes.
So suddenly I had a reason, and we flew over there and went to Canberra, and they were very nice, photographed boxes, and they showed me all around how they test things, and showed me parts of a helicopter rotor that failed. I think about that now and then. That's how that went ahead.
And I guess this process it's a long-term process in order to get the approval, or is it just a matter of showing your work, showing a few connections that you had, and they said okay, or did you?
Yeah, I showed them some of the work, mm-hmm. and they said okay, yeah.
It was pretty simple, and just the United States was interesting.
I even had Maurice Hinchey write a letter,
uh-huh.
who was our local congressman at the time, wonderful congressman, and that didn't help.
Yeah. And this is all, again, post 9/11.
Yes.
Yeah, you said that.
And I think that also probably was part of it. Although they did tell me that at the U.S., they gave the boxes back to the airlines, so they may not have had that many anyway.
Right. And when did the, or transition us to the aerial stuff then? When did you decide to make cityscapes? I mean, it's not new to you, I'm sure, but when did you?
Well, it started about, 6 or 7 years ago. I started thinking about shooting from the air again. Mm-hmm. And I have a friend who had a Cessna 182 up in Kingston, and he loves to fly and has a commercial license. And I asked him if he wanted to fly down, and we fly over the airports in Manhattan, JFK and so forth. So that's how it started off. When one afternoon, late afternoon, we flew down there, and the window of his plane would open so I could shoot out, and we got permission to circle over Kennedy, and I started shooting airports first. We made a number of trips over different airports, and at that time, it was really difficult to get night shots because I was still shooting with the CCD chip, mm-hmm. and as soon as you went past 200, it just broke up. Mm-hmm. So I also started using the Canon at night. Later, I got a Sony, the AR-7 II, and I still use that sometimes for the darker night shots or if I'm not carrying a heavier camera.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of the approval, is that something that the pilot would radio in and ask for? Or is that something you had to arrange ahead of time?
Yeah. Well, they like it if you arrange ahead of time. Right. We didn't always do that. Right. It depends how busy they are. It depends who's on. And we didn't always, you know, get permission at the airports, but enough times we did.
They're not very glamorous from the air airports. They just really look like processing plants. They really, really do. Except for the aircraft.
It's the aircraft.
That's all there is. But the rest of it, it's just warehousing. It looks like anything that you'd fly over in an industrial zone.
Actually, you know, I kind of disagree. I like to see the way they arrange.
The spidering and the pattern.
Well, everyone has lines on the painted lines, the patterns, the numbers. Mm-hmm. Some of that can actually be quite graphic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's one shot you had also when they were doing the movie about Captain Sully.
Oh, yeah. That was actually... Universal Studios in Hollywood. I saw the plane there and I thought, what the heck? You know, and I photographed it and then I went back and looked it up and I found out that that was actually the same plane. It was an Airbus, I think A320, and they took the wings off it and they hauled it from wherever and set it up in their in their back lot.
The one thing I liked about that shot was that gigantic blue screen.
Yeah.
So that's insane. And the blue screen. And they actually had the quarter ends of the ferry boats built. And they were doing something when I was flying over because there were some lights on at the time.
Interesting. Okay, we're going to take a short break. And we come back, we're going to talk about aerial photography with Jeff Milstein. Stay tuned.
We hope you're enjoying this edition of the B&H Photography Podcast. Send us a tweet at BH Photo Video, hashtag BH Photo Podcast.
We are back. First question I have for this section of the podcast, do you shoot from helicopters as well as fixed wing aircraft, or is it predominantly fixed wing?
Both.
Okay. Preference?
Helicopter.
Same here. Yeah. I used to do a lot of marine photography, boating, and helicopter.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. A Bell Jet Ranger to me was the best tripod made.
You had money. I never hired one.
It wasn't
one of
my
those.
Money. It was other people's money.
Oh, okay.
I don't have $1,500 now for that. But
No, it's more now.
Yeah. here's another question since helicopters, doors or no doors?
No doors.
Okay. All right. Harness or no harness?
No harness.
Ooh.
Only time I did have a harness was in England. Shooting at Gatwick. However, I find when you stick yourself out, the wind shakes everything, shakes your camera. I'd rather get them to do a steep turn. Now, some people get sick. In fact, I've had pilots get sick, but I like that, and it doesn't bother me.
You like getting sick?
No. I like the steep turns.
No, I've done, but I know what you mean. Exactly. It's a buffeting. It's crazy.
So let me get this straight. The door's open.
Yeah.
And you have no harness.
Oh, I have a seatbelt.
A seatbelt.
Yeah.
Okay.
I try to be careful not to unhook it.
Okay. I could show you a neat little thing to do with gaffer tape for a quick release on that. It's a good simple way of doing it.
I always think sometimes I ought to tape it, you know. But, the truth is, if the pilot's flying correctly, you should not be falling out. The G-force should be down. But now and then you do get a puff of air and it knocks you, so yeah.
We used to take the seat out too, and I'd have a harness around me. We'd buckle it into the base of the floor, and I would step out and stand on the skid.
Oh,
now it gets windy, but you could balance yourself. Yeah. Now I also knew some guy who would do the same thing without a harness.
Right,
he worked
with
the
crazy.
Same pilot all the time, and they were a team.
That's insane.
And he was able to gimbal himself and pivot himself, and I'd look and watch him. I thought he was insane, but he was just part of the aircraft. He needs one big gust and the game's over, but
and that can happen. And, you know, they can circle and hit their slipstream. But you need the bigger helicopters to do that. You need the turbines, and I'm usually in a putt-putt.
Mm. And what about the relationship with the pilot? Obviously you don't always have the same pilot, but how important is the communication and how is that?
It is important. Yeah. And some pilots seem to, for some reason, get you to a better spot. And I'm always going, you know, more right, more left, more north, more south.
A lot of pilots specialized in photography. And again, I used to do this a lot. And there were two or three pilots who I would try to get all the time. The communication was minimum. They knew exactly what I was trying to do, mm-hmm. and they knew how to put me where we had to mm-hmm. be.
Yeah.
And I think most good pilots, if they fly photographers, it's kind of second nature for a mm-hmm. lot of them. Better ones, anyway.
Yeah.
So, do you have a checklist that you go through when we're about to go up in the air? Because once you're up there, you can't go back to the car to get something you forget.
No, and I have made a mistake. I forgot once the controller for my gyro. I had the battery in the gyro, but not the controller. I was up in the air when I figured that out.
Do you still use gyros, or you depend on image stabilization?
Well, you know, with that Sony AR-7, it's so good. I can get away without a gyro.
I have not shot from the rear with built-in image stabilization. I used to have the add-on stabilizers, and they were beasts. They worked beautifully, but I wasn't sure how it compared to the latest.
The Sony was beautiful. I used it over England because I hadn't actually planned to do that, but I ended up getting a helicopter there and on a vacation and then flying over London. Mm. And all I had was my Sony, so perform beautifully.
Good to know.
All right. Okay, going back to Allan's question, can you kind of just run us down a list of the gear that you'll bring with you on a typical flight?
Yeah. Now what I've been using is the Phase 1. I usually bring two or three lenses of an 80, a 110, and recently I got the 150. So I've just started to use that a little bit.
So they're longer focal length?
Only if I want to go in on something and we're higher up.
Okay.
The 80 is pretty much the most used. So I have the camera, the lenses, the gyro, extra batteries, extra chips. I usually bring the A7R as my backup camera and a lens or two if the other camera fails, so I have something to go to.
Right.
I've had that happen, actually. I had a Contax body. I was shooting cruise ships, and the shutter reached its 100,000th or whatever in the helicopter and literally failed. When I opened it up, the shutter blades had kind of crunched themselves. And there I was in the helicopter. So,
oops.
you always have to have a backup.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of strange when you see blades in your image when you're flying in a helicopter. That could be unnerving.
Well, it wasn't in the image. I mean, later on, when I took the lens off, I
actually had blades show up in my pictures. I had a Nikon a shutter blow on me during a job.
Yeah.
And it was literally like little blades floating around in front of it.
Yeah, I can't remember. Maybe I did see blades. I don't remember.
And what lenses do you use when you with the A7R?
The 35, the 50. I have the 21 Loxia, I think it is.
Yeah, okay.
And then I have an 80. I have both the 80 Zeiss and the 80 Sony.
And can you...
No lens babies.
No lens babies. Oh, and I did get the newer version of the 24 to 70.
Explain to me a little bit the gyro and how it works. And
Yeah.
You want to do it? Go for
sure.
It.
Sure. Oh, you want to tell them?
I've used them, but you're the guest. Go for it.
Okay. I use a Ken Labs gyro.
I think that's the only company that makes them, if I'm not mistaken. They're in Connecticut, too,
yes.
I believe, right?
Yeah. Randy in Connecticut, right. And I, at first I had the 4X, I think it was, and it's fairly heavy. And for traveling, I wanted to get something lighter. So I ended up selling that and buying the 6.
If I may add this, what it physically looks like, think of a giant Tylenol. It's about 10 inches long, except that it's, a black or gray metal container that mounts onto the base of your camera, and inside of it are two gyroscopes that spin at ridiculously high speeds. It's battery driven in opposite directions, and it takes a few minutes for them to get up to full speed. When they do, when you pick this thing up, it's actually stabilizing. If you just hold it, say it'll turn your hands, and you bolt it to the camera, and it actually acts as a stabilizing device. It's actually hard to turn the camera. You have to fight it. And it's a very strange experience that you have to get used to it. You have to make very subtle corrections on it, but it'll hold your camera steady so you could be shooting while flying 90 miles an hour over a speedboat and get a sharp boat with cream blowing out underneath the hull because it's just a long exposure. You can shoot for a quarter of a second, 1 second at 90 miles an hour.
I can't shoot at a quarter of a second. Maybe you can.
I've done it.
Yes.
So anyway, the five-way, the image stabilization in the cameras, I guess, is...
It's better.
It's better. And it's got to be easy to work because this is a big, bulky device.
It's a heavy thing, yeah. My shoulders are really sore after 2 hours of holding.
It's fighting the camera, yeah.
The heavy FX with the heavy lenses and the gyro, and then he's going into steep turns where you're getting Gs. It can be a struggle.
Yeah.
And is there a shutter release on it?
No. It goes in the bottom.
So you're holding the camera itself.
And you're holding the camera. This is basically hanging off the base of your camera. Gotcha. If you've ever driven a heavy car without power steering, that's what it's like working with this thing. Mm-hmm. It's like you're fighting this thing. It works, but you really have to tangle with it.
Yeah, I can picture it kind of. And what about safety precautions? I mean, I know you mentioned that you're not using a harness. Is there something that we wouldn't think of? And even in terms of the way you physically keep your body when you're in these positions?
Bring warm clothing.
That's an important thing.
It can be 90 degrees down here. Yeah. You go up 1,000 feet or so. Yeah. It gets cold.
Yes.
Very quickly.
So that's one of your checklist items.
All right.
I usually put on these things that hold your glasses on your head, the straps are in the back, because sometimes the headphones work loose and I'm afraid my glasses will fall off or something. So I sometimes bring an extra pair of glasses.
And why don't you use a harness?
The smaller helicopters, there's really not so much of a use if you're not going to be stepping out.
Yeah, you don't need them, you know.
Okay. It's more if you're really going to get out and stand on it.
Have you ever dropped anything?
You know, I haven't, and I worry about it. I think about that and I try to keep everything away from the door and, you know, turn away if I'm changing a lens or something. But, I do worry about that.
Do you work with an assistant?
Not in the helicopter.
Not in the helicopter, yeah. Okay.
But you're talking about things that go weird in helicopters. I was once on a project where we were shooting out over the water here, out past Far Rockaway, and we came back. We left from 34th Street Heliport over here, and we were waiting. It was very busy, so we're hovering about 2,000 feet over the East River. It was evening, and waiting for clearance to come down. And we had one door open just the window. It was pretty cold up there. A gust of wind came through. The door next to me on the right side was imploded. It's some kind of a high, it's a Lexan door. It imploded into three pieces, shot through the cabin, and blew the other door out.
Holy
and all Christ. Of my gear was in a Halliburton case that my assistant just reached and grabbed the handle as it was going out the door.
Boy, I've never heard of anything like that.
Been there, done that. You don't want to do it. Trust me. Hmm. Okay.
Did you ever figure out what caused it?
The pilot believes there was some kind of a fracture in the door itself that just gave in. The back pressure came in. But I got one piece of Lexan right across the face. It was like somebody just slugged me. I didn't even know it hit me.
Wow. If it was sharp, it could have been.
It could have been real ugly. Yeah. And he didn't lose stability. But then a few minutes later, we landed and everything was fine. Hmm. Went out for a nice drink after that. anyway.
Wow.
Can you talk a bit about the times of day that you choose? Do you have preferences in terms of times?
Yeah, please. Yeah, I always try to go the last hour of sun and the first hour of twilight and dark. Mm-hmm. So I can combine both shots in a single shoot.
Right. The air is also more stable at that time too, coincidentally. Mm-hmm. You have less wind going on at that point in time.
And are you also at that point just shooting one take at one image at a time, or do you shoot on continuous?
One image at a time. Again, the cameras that I'm using are not fast enough to...
And what is it? I mean, obviously, at least in terms of the New York stuff I've seen, patterns, geometric shapes are very important. Is that what you're looking for? Mm-hmm. And is it the goal to capture as much as you can in camera, or you don't worry about that and you just fix it later?
Oh, no, I worry about that. you can do some fixes, but if you get it right in the camera, your life is much easier. Right.
And there seems to be, to be straight looking down is the point, correct?
Well, for a lot of the work. Not everything I do is straight down. I do some that aren't. But there is a straight down body of work, and it is very geometrical, and I like to line things up, and I think that does trace back probably to my architectural training. Mm-hmm. A lot of the pictures are like floor plans of something or other, and I remember studying the great cities and great piazzas in Europe and all of that and how cities are formed, and I just think it's very interesting, the man-made landscape from the air, and how there's like the streets, and you look at all these taxi cabs in New York, and they're almost like blood cells in an artery, and they're doing the same thing, really. They're moving information, and they're moving the lifeblood of the city. So it's almost like patterns that are organic repeat themselves in the man-made environment.
Absolutely.
Now, do you prefer helicopters for doing that kind, because you could position yourself? Again, you're talking about creating grids, and your stuff is very geometric. In a fixed-wing aircraft, I could see that being really difficult, having to keep circling around just trying to catch it, whereas with a helicopter, you could stay in a fixed position and shoot for a few moments anyway.
You can stay in a fixed position if you're not tilted. If you're tilted, you have to be turning.
True.
But it's much slower than an airplane. And you have this huge open, and you can be lower.
Yeah.
And it's much easier. The plane is going fast. You're higher up because you can't fly around New York low. So you have to go pretty high. And the airplane shots of the cities are much higher. It's a nice look. It's a different look. And it's much more of that kind of computer board grid look, whereas the helicopter pictures zero in more on particular areas like Columbus Circle or the park or the 9/11 memorial or something.
Some of the fun pictures you have of the Thanksgiving Day parade from up in the air. It's like you're looking at the cityscape and you realize, wait a second, there's a dinosaur in the middle of Fifth Avenue. It's kind of fun.
Yeah.
The scale is ridiculous.
And is there a chosen or a favorite altitude that you prefer to shoot from, or do you change that based on the series and the aesthetics that you're looking for? Can you talk about that a bit?
It does change. Around New York, you're usually between 1 and 2,000. going higher, you could get into the altitudes that LaGuardia is using or something like that.
Imagine if you're shooting in any metropolitan area, you got to do a lot of checking of rules and regulations before you do anything like
that. Yeah, there's always some areas that that's a problem. They, you know, you can probably get permission for a short time to do something, but there are places that, you know, because the they're on the flight paths, you know, especially in LA, there's certain areas that you just, you know, can't really hang around.
And you basically rely on the pilots to...
They're talking to center and or the tower, depending on where you are, and getting the permissions. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it varies, again, to who's on at the on that day.
Right. I want to get back really quickly to the idea of the aesthetics of the image you're creating and this idea of looking straight down to get the grids and the patterns. Did it take you a while to find that? Did it come to that? Or is that something you knew right away that you wanted to distinguish yourself from other aerial photographers to some degree by looking straight down and by concentrating on the patterns of the city?
Well, it started when I was doing the airports. And and then I, you know, during that time, it transitioned to wanting to shoot more straight down because I liked the patterns. Mm-hmm. They became kind of abstract geometry.
Absolutely.
And so that became what I was interested in, what I liked to do, and it just felt right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Have you played around with drones at all?
I look at pictures of them.
Uh-huh. Pictures of them or taken by them?
Both.
Okay.
I mean, I see the ads when I say I look at pictures of them. I
imagine it must intrigue you because you go through a lot of pain and effort to do this. In the meantime,
well, here's the problem.
Please, go ahead.
Legally, they're limited to 400 feet in line of sight.
Mm-hmm.
And when I get in a helicopter, I can zip around and do a lot of work and you know, I would have to go to different places, and then I'm limited to the 400 feet.
And 12 minutes of flight
do
time.
Do I really want to put $50,000 worth of camera in a drone?
If you have a $100,000 drone, yeah.
Well, okay. there you go.
But that takes away all the fun, right?
That's right.
Do you have a $100,000 person controlling it?
There you go. Yeah, no, okay. All right, but I imagine, have you – been tempted to play around a little bit that?
You know.
It's a teaser for you. It has to be.
I've thought about it, but I'm at a point in my life where I can't read another manual.
So can I ask, how much does it cost to rent a – I mean, obviously there's differences in prices, but in general to rent a the kind of helicopter you use?
Yeah. New York's a little more expensive than L.A., and then you can, if you buy more hours, they'll give you a cheaper price. But generally, it's around the lowest you're going to get. It's in the maybe $550 range, and $700 is probably $700-$800 for the little bigger ones out of New Jersey.
If you have some kind of a jet. Power type.
Now, then you're getting up into thousands.
Then it's, yeah, then it used to be 1,500. I imagine it's more than that now.
Yeah,
but like, you can cover more territory.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but not so much more. I mean, unless you're flying from a faraway place to where you're going, once you're where you are, you know, you don't want to be going fast taking the pictures. You want to be slowed down anyway.
As long as you can keep up with your subject. That's the truth.
Well, that's when you're photographing moving things. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
And again, questions about post-production for the aerial photography photos. Same thing.
Well,
adjusting,
you know,
cropping.
All of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you're shooting in RAW when you're shooting with these kinds of cameras. So it's a very flat image. Mm-hmm. So first of all, you're going to be doing a lot of work to bring out the image. And then, if it's angled somewhat, I'll you know, crop, you know, rotate it, crop, and, you know, try to make it parallel lines a little bit.
And what do you work with at home? What is your monitor setup? And
I have the Apple Tower, the black tower and the ISO, is that how you say it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The ISO monitors and—
That's what I use, those are nice.
Yeah, and then I've got some Pegasus multi-bank backups and they fill up, and then I've got a whole stack of Lossy Orange—
Portable drives.
Portable drives.
Yeah. And are you always envisioning the print, the final print, when you're doing this work?
Oh, yeah. That's, I mean, not just the final print, but a large final print. Mm-hmm. If anybody gets a chance to go down to Ben Ruby and see the show before it closes on the 17th, they'll get to see a number of 70-inch prints. And I like to make big prints that you can stand in front of and really, you know, discover things. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. What's your biggest printer right now? When we first met, I know it was a 44-inch, and I think you were looking at a 60.
I have the 11880, okay, which is a 64-inch Epson, and it's a great machine. I use it all the time. So I can get a 62 by 84-inch and still have a border on it.
Right.
But if I'm going to get much bigger than that, I have to go to a light jet or something.
And you do all the printing yourself?
I do everything that's under that size,
under
yeah.
That size, right.
Yeah.
And what paper?
I usually use, I've tested a lot of papers, and honestly, I've come back to the Epson Premium Luster. I haven't found any paper that really looks substantially better.
A lot of people come back to that paper. They play around, they come back.
I mean, if I want a 64-inch paper because somebody wants a bigger one, I'll use the Epson Exhibition Fiber.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of other good papers out there, but I just, everything's, you know, tuned to that and it works.
Yeah, that's it.
Have you gotten requests from people, from buyers to say, hey, you know, give me a shot with my building in it, or, you know, give me a shot with something I'd like and then I'll buy that, or is that?
You know, I've had some nibbles with people that have a plane or a boat, but nothing's, I had actually a email from a guy in Santa Monica, has a small airline, which uses these Pilatus single engine turbines, and he wants a picture. And so, I don't know, maybe something will happen there. Mm-hmm. I told him I'll trade him for some flight time.
There you go.
Do you own your own plane?
I did up until a couple of years ago, and I sold it because I just wasn't using it enough, and it was a low wing, which really didn't lend itself to photography. So I bought a quarter of a Cessna 182.
Mm. Okay.
Interesting. What's the future work looking like? Do you have any ideas?
You've done planes and you've done ships. What are you doing now?
Well, I also do some street work. I just came back from Havana, and really pleased with some of the work I got in Havana using the new Hasselblad X1D. Yeah, apart from a shutter malfunction, which caused me to lose a number of shots, they gave me a new camera. There's something wonderful about the chip and the lenses.
And the form factor is beautiful. It's such a small light.
Yes, and that's what I wanted it to walk around the streets. Yes. I can't walk around with a Phase 1 anymore. It's too heavy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But in terms of aerial work, is this idea of finding patterns?
Oh yeah,
what your main folk? I mean, do you want to go in a total different direction and shoot out in the desert? Or
well, I just got the impression going to Cuba must be totally different from what we've been talking about.
Islands,
up till now.
Yeah,
correct. Yeah, yeah, and I do have the book of Cuba street photography with Monticelli Press. I enjoy doing different things. I don't feel like I want to do only one type of photography. I'm looking forward to going to Europe and doing some aerial work there in the near future.
Which of your works has gotten the most attention from people? What have people come back with the most?
Right now, the aerials.
Specifically, which ones? Like, to me, the cruise ships just blow me away. That's just my thing.
Yeah. I mean, the cruise ships are great. I haven't sold as many of those as aircraft, but people, I mean, I've sold really across the board, cities, New York City, a number of pictures of New York City, some of the LA things like Disneyland, beaches.
That's another thing I liked.
Museums.
A lot of your beach scenes, my favorite ones are where you have, it's sort of like in thirds, you have water.
Yeah.
The boardwalk and the beach, and then the homes or the business inside. And it's sort of like this triptych thing going on there. And then you'll have a pier going through it, just bisecting all of them.
Yeah.
And some of those are a lot of fun. And the amusement parks at night.
Yeah, there's one of a pier there that's extremely sharp. Yeah. And there was a picture of Coney Island that's become iconic. It was put on Time's blog and got like 34,000 likes or something.
Wow. Nice.
That was actually in Vanity Fair a few months ago. And that sold out. There's no more for sale. There's one, actually, but basically it's sold out. And I love amusement.
Large prints?
What's that?
Large prints?
Because that's night, it was limited to 54 inches.
Okay. Limited to 54 inches.
Yeah.
And you do addition them to a certain
level? Yeah. Yeah. There's a small edition of 10 and a large edition of 10. And within the large edition, there's a few sizes, but limited to 10 total. So, I love amusement parks. That's the Santa Monica Pier and Disneyland. You know, I never went over Disneyland because I read there was a no-fly zone over it. It's the only private company with a no-fly zone in the country.
Really?
Yeah. You can do some research on it.
I always knew Mickey was up to new
things. Yes. Yeah.
There's something about that rat that bothered me.
Yeah. But then I looked at it a little closer and I saw it was only to 3,000 feet. So I said to my helicopter, let's go to Disneyland. And we actually had to go to 4,000 feet because of an airport nearby. So I had to shoot Disneyland from 4,000 feet, but I got some nice shots.
Great. Any advice, anything you might want to throw in as we wrap this up?
I would say shoot as fast of a speed as you can, unless you're shooting with a camera with a really good image stabilizer, because otherwise you're going to come back and be very sad when you blow up the pictures and see all the blurs.
I mean, I've only shot from a plane once, aerial photography once, and it was a thrill. Are you still getting a thrill every single time you're going up
there? I love it. I especially at night and the lights come on, and just going from place to place. When I'm shooting something, I'm so involved in it, I'm usually not thinking. I'm just doing the work. But between going from one place to another and I stop and look around at stuff, it's almost like going on vacation with a camera. You don't sometimes see your vacation. So it's almost like in between, I put the camera down and I enjoy the sights.
You also have that problem, yeah. So if I have a camera with me, I'm working. It's tough.
Yeah.
Good. Is there any other aerial photographers that you recommend or that you like, or someone's work that you just think, wow, how did they do that? How come I can't do that, et cetera?
Oh, yeah. George Steinmetz.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
I don't know him personally, but I admire him.
Sure. Jeff, if people want to see more of your work, what is your website? What about Instagram? Where should they go?
JeffreyMilstein.com is the website. And
that's M-I-L-S-T.
Right, one L.
One L.
And at Jeffrey Milstein is the Instagram.
Okay, I was looking at that. In fact, I printed it out over here. Got some great stuff on there. Terrific having you here as a guest. Good seeing you again.
Nice to see you again.
13 years or so. So it's a pleasure.
Let's plug the show, which is again at the Ben Ruby Gallery on 26th Street, I believe.
Or 26th Street, right near the High Line.
Uh-huh. And it's running through March
17th.
17th.
And the book LANY is available at Barnes & Noble's and Amazon.
Mm-hmm. There you have it.
All right.
Okay.
We also didn't talk about it, but that book on Palm Springs trailer homes is pretty interesting too, taking it from a home from the ground.
That was a fun little book.
Yeah. Great.
All right.
I actually had somebody email me very recently and said, because of your book, we bought a trailer home in Palm Springs and we love it.
Okay. Just a reminder, if you are not a subscriber to the B&H Photography Podcast, Why not? It's easy, and it doesn't cost you a dime to sign up. We have over 100 past episodes you can listen to. And to become a subscriber, all you have to do is head on over to Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, or Spotify, and in no time, you could be a card-carrying B&H podcast listener. Don't put it off. Sign up now. And not to hold you up, on behalf of Jason, John, and myself, thank you so much for tuning in today.